I was quite impressed by Shishir Jha's lecture yesterday, and he brought up some very important points. And as you'll realize, most things in life, when you're trying to communicate, if there's something important that you want to say, you need to repeat it. You need to repeat it as often as it takes to get that point across, whether it's your seminar, whether it's your MTP report that you're writing or whatever. If there's a point which is really important, you have to keep repeating it, right? Otherwise, what happens is that it's there in the text. Someone reads it, they might miss it, or they might miss the importance of it, and you feel that if it's really important, he'll repeat it again. Like if someone tries to call you and you don't have time, right? They'll call you once, you'll miss it. You'll think if it's important, he'll call you again, right? Third time, you pick it up, and then fine, you got it. Same thing in many things. If something is important, you need to repeat it. And I've learned this from masters. When I was at Oxford, there was our head of department was a gentleman called C.A.R. Hoare, H-O-A-R-E, right? He's, if you like, the gods of computer science, one of the people who are right up there, who've actually established the subject of computer science as mathematically rigorous and things like that. In fact, I would recommend that you read one of his papers called The Emperor's Old Clothes. How many of you have heard about that paper? It's called The Emperor's Old Clothes. It's his Turing Award lecture in 1981, right, where he talked about his journey in computer science. But what I would like to just review this morning is a few of the points which you thought were important yesterday. A few of the points that you thought were important yesterday, in yesterday's talk. Right? Like, it's quite interesting, the facts that Shishir mentioned, 25,000 journals, 1.5 million articles every year, one of those might be yours, right? How do you get that article noticed, right? Especially when there are 1 million authors. If there are 1 million authors writing scientific papers, how do you get yourself noticed amongst that large community, right? And then he talked about formal writing, and what he said about formal writing appears to, it applies to all sorts of communication, right? So what are the important elements that he mentioned in formal writing? How should it be? Simple. What else?
Well organized.
You're reading it out. What else?
Coherent.
One very important point that struck me very, very hard. Generous. What does generous mean, right? Generous, what does it mean? It's very important. That point is very, very important. You don't realize the importance of it now, but as time goes on, you realize more. I'll give you an instance of this. One paper writing style I've learned from Professor Hoare is, you know, when often you find students are writing, they will write, I did this, then I did that, then I found this, 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 and this happened, and then I surmised that this is the rule that might be holding, and then I am presenting the results and all that kind of stuff, right? And then the same thing if you hear in a slightly different way. He's saying exactly the same thing. If we do this, then we notice this, and we notice that we can presume that this holds, and if we tabulate the results, we see a graph with these interesting properties. What is the difference in the two styles? Yeah, the first is egotistic. I'm great, look what I've discovered. Let me share with you, kind of thing, you know. The second style is we. Now, this is the man who's up there, Tony Hoare. When he writes we. So he's saying that we are both the same level. Right? And when he says that we are both the same level, we actually rise to that level. This is a very, very important thing. You'll find that, you know, when you have a few achievements to your credit, you want to, you know, tom-tom it and say, I. But when you have a lot of achievements, you want to share. So I'm saying that often many things in life, you know, if you imagine yourself to be a particular way, you actually become that. So this communication skills course is not so much about writing and reading and so on. It is more metaphysical, you know, in the sense that you should realize your place in the universe. And if you believe that you are strong, you are kind, you are generous, you actually become that. And it will manifest itself in your persona in all sorts of ways. But if you feel victimized, if you feel a victim, if you feel that everybody is trying to screw me, you become a very bichara kind of person. And you start behaving bichara also. And it shows in your writing, it shows in your speech, it shows in everything. You kind of meditate on this thing. That's why many of these sadhus and all that, some of them meditate on what? A deer skin. Some of them meditate on a tiger skin. When he wants power, he meditates on a tiger skin. Why? Because constantly he is believing that he is getting the properties of a tiger. When you start believing in yourself and you start believing all these things that you are strong and powerful, you actually start projecting it. So anyway, this is a behind the scenes kind of look. So these things are very important. What else? Generous. So generous is not only being generous to the reader, giving them the benefit of the doubt that they are also intelligent. You're believing that they are intelligent, so you're being generous. And if you're quoting somebody else, if you borrowed from somebody else, right, my respect will go up for you if you're acknowledging that, look, I'm not that great that I've thought everything myself. I'm actually standing on the shoulders of other people who've done this work. That doesn't belittle you. It doesn't make you seem less. It makes you seem more precise. It makes you seem more generous. It makes you feel more honest. You appear much more honest when you candidly say that, look, ye mera kaam nahi hai, ye iska kaam hai, but I've added this to it. In fact, you appear much smarter in the process. Okay, so don't think by passing off somebody else's work as part of your thinking, you actually appear great. Because we know what to expect, you know, everybody knows what to expect. And that honesty is a quality which is the most important when we look for people to work with, say in a team, right? What do you look for? Same things the faculty looks for, same thing everybody else, same thing the world looks for outside. What is a good quality of a team member? We'll be dividing you up into teams of six, right, to work on your project. But what are the qualities that you look for? Pardon? Do their own work. That means they should work, hardworking. What else? Honesty. If he's not done the work, he says that he's not done it and he tries to, okay? Or doesn't pass off this guy's work as his own work. Taking responsibility. So there are a number of other points. If you just review your notes yesterday, right, I would say that two other points here are important, right? And rigor. That you don't make loose claims, that you are rigorous in your thinking. You just, and one more important thing, there's another thing saying specificity, right? The way you can tell a student's way of thinking apart from a professional or a faculty or a more advanced student is that you will never use words like what? Most. This system is much better than that system. This system is very fast. Right? Okay. You don't use vague words like that. You will say precise. This system is 20% better than that, right? Or it finds 10% more errors than this way of compiling the language and stuff like that. So you have to be precise and quantitative wherever you can, right? So anyway, these are just a few points that came up while reviewing yesterday's lecture. And what we'll do is that we'll put up some pointers to interesting papers. I'll just take 2 minutes more, Prakash. And one other very important point I came up with yesterday was writing to encounter doubts, to face your doubts, right? What does that mean? Doubt is very creative. Doubt is very interesting. Doubt is where all research happens. Doubt is where creative things happen, change happens. If you don't have doubt, then you know everything and you won't change. Right? Where you have doubt, there's a possibility of change. In fact, this whole factory that we have here called IIT is a factory of doubt, basically. That's where we create, we enjoy doubt, we revel in doubt, because wherever there's doubt, we have a role to play. Where there's no doubt, then you go to industry. That's what industry is about. Industry doesn't like doubt. Industry likes to destroy doubt. Because doubt makes them feel insecure. Am I doing the right thing? Do I have the right product? Am I marketing it the right way and so on? While here we thrive on doubt. We create doubt where there is none. I'll give you an example. One very good PhD was a student of mine, Samir Sasrabudde. We had this language that we used to teach, a reconfigurable computing language on the embedded systems course called Handle C, right? And I thought this was the greatest language you could do. You could build hardware using a C type of language, right? And you can do parallel processing in it at the gate level. So you compile this C-like program to an FPGA. And he had his own thing. He said, sir, I don't know why we have to do things this way. Why can't the compiler do all this work and decide where to parallelize? Why do I have to, right? So he planted a doubt in our head, right? And out of that doubt came a beautiful PhD, and he's got a wonderful job with Synopsys, which now he's going other places and stuff like that. So the doubt opens. So all of you in your seminar and your MTP are going to be attempting to create doubt. Doubt in your situation is very healthy, because doubt is asking a question. Your job is to question and to create doubt. You should not swallow anything that a paper says. They might have made some mistakes or overlooked some results or misinterpreted some results, and they've got away with it. Right? You must believe that you're equally smart to be able to catch those things and come up with a new way of doing things. That's the whole point of an MTP. Right? Instilling doubt and trying to relate to that. Okay. Doubt is also useful in another context. If you have some uljans, you know, like you have choices in life. I can do this, I can do that, I can do that. And you can't decide which is the right one. Whether it's this person, I should go and marry that person, you can't decide, right? This job, that job, that. It's like comparing apples with oranges. You cannot compare them. They're not on the same scale. Someone's good at this, someone's good at that, right? Your heart is wanting this. Which is the right way to do things? I used to find a very interesting way of resolving these things. When I was a student, I used to be very close to my Nana, my grandfather. He was a very erudite man, very learned and stuff like that. And I used to write a letter to him. Right? In the writing of that letter, I would express all my doubts and reason them out. And in the process, a lot of doubts would get resolved. And eventually, you didn't have to mail that letter after that. The letter had done its work, right? This was especially because I was abroad in those days, and anything that you send back which is slightly negative, everybody gets very worried, you know, right? I'm sure you have the same story to tell. So you write it down, and then you confront everything and deal with it. Similarly, now you'll find when you're looking around your seminar topics and so on, what you're trying to do is trying to find doubts, trying to find gaps in the existing knowledge. That's the way you should be doing your reading. Right? So that's why we gave you that quick exercise also. You saw a TED talk, you did a summary of it, right? And you'll notice we've not given you much time to kind of react to it. Like, how many of you have been able to write a critique yet? Okay. The submission deadline is tonight, right? Don't sort of go to town and spend too much time over it. Just write an initial reaction. The reason we want that document is that in the next class you can proofread it. Right? So don't spend 1 week thinking about it and writing it up. You'll have enough time to do that in the project that you're doing. Okay. So that's it about doubt. And fine. Then he talked about plagiarism and things like that. See, that happens when you think that you're weak, that you're not fast enough, you're not good enough, you can't think well enough and stuff like that, and then you borrow from other places and present the work as your own. But as you, as I said, if you repeat that mantra, that I am strong, I am kind, I am generous and creative, right? Just repeat it to yourself morning and evening, you'll find that you'll have a change happening and you'll think very differently, okay? So we'll get on with the class, and we stopped halfway last time in correcting the proof. What we'll do in this class is that we'll complete that exercise, and then would you believe it, Prakash has some more information to share with you about the use of comma. Right? We take it for granted. It seems a very small thing, but not when you actually use these things. You know, you feel often that you get away with your language and with your English, but a person who knows, you show yourself up, you know, very, very obviously in your language and the way you express yourself. So it's very good to master these details, right? So we'll go with this, and in the next class, we'll have two things going. One is we'll do the proofreading of the documents that you submit tonight. And we'll continue with a few of those videos. We wanted to complete that, you know, your video record if you like, because then you can compare and contrast afterwards. Okay, thanks.
Sorry, I took some time, but
no problem. Morning, everybody. So last time we had an exercise which you all had, and then we were going through the model solution. So we had come part of the way. How far had we come? Up to which line number we had come? What was the last line number we checked? Enlarge kar diya. Is it visible? So we are at line 25. The second problem, the spelling of second is wrong because there is R extra. So this says delete and close. And problem B is missing. B is missing. Is to make corrections by using. Even corrections using is also correct English, but it should be by using the marks and symbols devised. This device spelling is wrong. It should be devised. So it says S over here. By professional proofreaders. The spelling of professional is wrong. It is written as PROFF. It should be PROFFSSION. So one F is cancelled here, this is delete. And after S, we add another S. Proofreaders, then any trend typesetter will understand. This then should be that. That any trend typesetter will understand. So N is cross trend, we have put T there. The third and most difficult, see, after third we have put an M dash to highlight the phrase which is coming next. So that after that phrase we have to again put an M dash. So this says here that you put M dash. M dash should come like parenthesis. You can't have a single M dash coming. Most difficult problem for authors proofreading their own works is to resist the temptation to rewrite in proofs. This is a bit technical because manuscript editor this says should be small caps and the first letter of each should be large cap. So this is too technical, you need not bother about this.
One more thing is proofreading their own work, it could be also, right?
No, their own works. The previous one was words. But here now, whatever you have written, works means. So you shouldn't rewrite into that. This is actually instruction to all of you. The whole passage is authors as proofreaders, so it is addressed to you. The content, we haven't bothered about content because we were concentrating on the form. But if you read the content, each sentence is meaningful in its own way. And this enlarge should be put here. Can be reduced, in size is not required because reduced means in size only. And this should be joined back here. So this was the model solution, you can say. So we have finished with the, now you have brought your sheets back, which you should submit at the end of the class, because we'll be doing a statistical analysis of them and find out what is the error distribution. And after you have practiced this, that distribution should shift to the actual error count. You should come closer to detecting all the errors. So after that we come to the main topic of today's talk, that is use of commas. Many people are surprised that there is so much to learn about commas to spend one or two lectures. You might have known this, small things make perfection. But perfection is not a small thing. So this is why we have to learn about commas, because commas are the smallest elements in what we write, but they are probably the most frequent single elements. So firstly, what is your impression about commas? Why do we use commas? Can anybody tell? You have learnt it in school, so you must be having some ideas about why we use commas. Pause for what? While reading you are supposed to pause? Because these are meant for written language, not for voicing it out. Means do they have to do with structure of the sentence or the function of the sentence?
Will you repeat the question so it's on record?
Oh, okay. His question, his answer. He said the first one you said is to indicate pause, where we pause. So normally we pause while talking, we don't pause while reading. In fact, we read so fast that we don't really stop anywhere. So that means if we are speaking out the sentence, where we would have paused, that is where commas are put. That is what you want to say. Right? And the other person said, to improve understanding. Yesterday you saw three examples of use of commas where in absence of comma, there was a confusion. The meaning could be wrongly conceived. So that is one application of commas. That is for disambiguation. Comma, in a sentence, if it is likely to be misread, then when you use a comma, the meaning becomes clear and you don't misread. So in yesterday's lecture, you saw examples of that. That is one of the applications we'll see. But that is almost the last application. There are other applications. So as he suggested, when we are speaking a sentence, we don't speak continuously. We tend to speak in packets. And when the packet ends and next packet starts, there is a small gap or there is a change of intonation. And that is where we put commas if we write out the sentence. So one reason we stop while speaking is for breathing, because we can't speak continuously. But that is not the reason why commas are put, because normally a sentence can be spoken in a single breath. So you don't need to pause for breathing. So what happens is, when we conceive a sentence, we conceive it in chunks of meaning, like what we call phrase or clause or sentence. So sentence identification is simple because we use a full stop for that, because a sentence expresses a complete thought. The next smaller element is clause. You might have done clause analysis in school, that adjective clause, noun clause, etc. So clause is a fraction of a sentence, but which is also fairly meaningful. It can be almost a complete sentence. And a phrase is the next smaller group, which is a group of words, which by itself will not make any sense. Only when used with along with other words, it will make sense. And the next, of course, is words. So this is the hierarchy of structure of a sentence. So end of a sentence, we mark with a full stop. And in other places, for clauses, we use commas. So commas are used to separate elements used in a sentence. Those elements can be words. Elements can be phrases, elements can be clauses. If you see your sheet, this is a zip version of the whole thing. So it's not very easy to read. The first column says, we won't bother about the technicalities, we'll go through the examples mainly. Technicalities you can read later. Is the elements which you are using can be either of equal rank or unequal rank. You will see the top half is all elements of equal rank and bottom half of the table is elements of unequal rank. And the second condition is unconditional use, that is syntactic, that is the structure of the sentence needs the comma. And second, lower half of top is conditional, that is semantic, means it depends on the meaning. So some of the commas depend on meaning, some of the commas don't. That they are mandatory. So we'll consider the top half of this page. The first row is, it says conventions. If you want to refer the type of comma, it is by convention. Even if you don't put, it does not matter, but it has been agreed that comma shall be used in these places. So, and the category used is word, that is between words. We are starting with the smallest element of a sentence and see where commas are used between words. So the first is name and title. Between name and title, here Professor Isaac, PhD, will visit. So after Professor Isaac, Professor Isaac was a professor in computer science department, so you may not be knowing him because he was an old timer. Next is within address. The address elements like CRECIT is the name of the building, then IIT is name of the institution, Powai is the name of the suburb. So when the type of element changes, you put commas there, that the type of element, but type of address you are referring to had changed. These first two lines is actually one sentence. Professor Isaac, PhD, will visit CRECIT, IIT Powai, Mumbai 76. This, for both of them, there is a single sentence. Next is geographical names. That is, CRECIT is in Mumbai, comma, India. Because Mumbai and India are two different categories. One is a city, one is a country. Next is within date. So if you write the date like this, that month first and then the date, then you have to put a comma after the date because it might get mixed up with the year if you write in continuation. So if these two numbers come together, you have to put a comma. But if you write like this in the last column, like 5 January 2013, then you don't have to put a comma anywhere because you are alternating between numbers and words. So you know these are different categories. Then these numbers are, these are mathematical numbers. We are not telephone numbers or such things. So Indian way is from right hand side, after first three, we count thousand, then we count lakhs, then we count crores. So after that, it is in steps of two. And Western way is after everything, because you have thousand, then million, then billion, etc. So you have to put comma so that identifying a number becomes simple. The last column says that in telephone number, you should not put commas because telephone number is not really a number. It is just a sequence of digits. And if you want to identify the groups, then you, after area code and exchange code, etc., you can put hyphen. Telephone number is not really a number. And in PIN code has no punctuation. You shouldn't put comma, full stop, anything. And the six digits should be written together. You shouldn't write as 3 and 3. Because that is also not a number. PIN code is not a sequential number. Then next is coordinating conjunctions. So these and, but, or, nor, for, so, yet. These are the only 7 conjunctions, coordinating conjunctions in English language. So first example is by now and pay later. So and is coordinating between these two clauses. So before and we have to put comma. And one variation is by now, pay later, where and can be eliminated, but comma cannot be eliminated. Because the clauses have to be separated. And is understood, buy now, pay later. It doesn't mean buy now or pay later. Similarly, but is many are called, but few are chosen. So before but, we have put a comma. Then or is to be or not to be. This is a famous sentence, as you know. Nor is he didn't attend, nor did he study. You might notice that while speaking, we wait where the comma occurs. That is, when the clause is complete, we tend to wait while speaking. Similarly, for, so, and yet. You might notice that NAND, which we know from logic, doesn't occur in ordinary language. Nor occurs, but NAND doesn't occur in language. It is an artificial construct for mathematics and logic.
So what about as?
About?
As
is not a coordinating conjunction. Before as, we'll go through, and if you notice as occurring anywhere, then we'll discuss. So words we have finished. Next is between clauses which we have finished. And this is between two elements. Coordinating conjunctions are binary operators. So you'll have exactly two things surrounding them. You won't have more than two. So it says equal to two. Third is series, like A, B and C, and A, B or C. So in a series with three or more elements, you have to put comma before the last and or. Series might contain 100 things, but before the last element we put and or, and before that we put a comma. This is a controversial comma because there are many opinions on this, but this is called an Oxford comma because Oxford University recommends, and in US it is called Harvard comma. So all universities recommend, because in absence of this, if you write ABC, you don't know whether it is A or B or C or A and B and C. The last and or tells you that the whole series was full of ands. It was A and B and C. So the last one indicates you have saved so many ands or so many ors. Otherwise, it means that only if you don't put a comma, it means only B and C. What is the relationship of A is not defined if you don't put a comma there. Yeah? Repeat. See, if you write A comma B and C, then A comma A is something. B and C are together, you know. But you don't know that A is also together. That and applies only between B and C. But if you put a comma before that, it indicates that all previous commas were followed by ands. It is a short form for that, so it should not be missed. Then absolute phrases. After? After what? Yeah, there should be a comma. Right, there should be a comma. It was missed out. So absolute phrases, this is the example. His paper folded, his pen closed, and his eyes shut. He sat patiently. So all these three are called absolute phrases. And separating absolute phrases, there should be a comma. Then predicates means you have one subject and many things being said about the subject. You have subject predicate as the construction of a sentence. So he is the subject of the sentence. And there are many things said about him. He could buy food, pay the bills, and invest in the banks. And this also illustrates the series. So before the and, we put comma. Then nouns and pronouns. So comma, semicolon, and full stop are punctuation marks. Similarly, verbs. He read, planned, and wrote. And adverbs. Write effortlessly, systematically, and correctly. The counter indication is he worked absolutely systematically, because absolutely is modifying the adverb systematically. Both are adverbs, but systematically modifies the verb worked. Well, absolutely is an adverb modifying another adverb. That's why there is no comma between them. It is related to the next adverb. Then semantic now. So there are two types of adjectives, that is coordinate or called non-restrictive and cumulative. So we'll just see the separate example. Rhodium is a hard white metal. So why there is a comma? Yes, it is a hard metal and it is a white metal. You can put it into two sentences and put an and there. This comma has saved the and. So, and in the second sentence, rhodium is a hard white metal, while silver is a soft white metal, because you are talking about white metals now, not just about metals. So now these two are together and there is no comma. Then prevent misreading is what we saw yesterday, in yesterday's class, in the common lecture. So if meaning is likely to become ambiguous, you put a comma. So to Amar, Joshi was a puzzle. Similarly, people who can write correctly. But many times you can eliminate the comma by changing the construction, as in the last column, that Joshi was a puzzle to Amar. Now there is no comma required and there is no confusion. Similarly, people who can write correctly are rare. This is additional qualification, but now there is no comma required. So with this, we have finished commas between equal elements. That is, both the elements are either clauses, phrases, or words. This is more like a mathematical comma. If you were to write in logic, because in logic you don't write an equation containing different, or mathematics containing different kinds of terms. All terms must have the same dimensions. So these are similar to that. Now next comes to the lower half, comes to between unequal elements. And unconditional means syntactic, that because of the structure of the sentence you have to put this comma. So noun or pronoun plus past participle. So he sat patiently, his papers folded, his pen closed, his eyes shut. All these are past participles, folded, closed, and shut. And you are talking about one person only. So these past participle words or phrases have to be separated by commas. Similarly, present participle. He stood silently, his legs trembling, his hands shaking, his eyes blinking. These are present participles. Where? Yeah, absolute phrases. Actually, both examples might look similar, but absolute phrase has a separate grammatical definition. So, same example might serve as both categories also. Now there, if you see, the construction is different. We'll discuss later on. What is an absolute phrase? We'll discuss later. Then next is interruption, which is not essential to grammatical structure. It is only to enhance the meaning. So transitional phrase, that is commas on the whole, account for most of the errors. Even if you remove this transitional phrase, the sentence will make sense. We are saying something extra. You can say commas account for most of the errors, which is also true. Similarly, contrasted phrase. Commas, unlike other punctuation marks, are widely used. Here also you can remove the phrase, contrasting phrase. Still the sentence has its own meaning. Then transitional word instead of a phrase. So commas, however, are often neglected. Here also you could have said commas are often neglected. Similarly, contrasted word. So parenthetical elements are separated by dashes, not hyphens. You could have ended the sentence with dashes also. Then direct address, when you are speaking to somebody and you call out that person, that is vocative, then that vocative is separated within the sentence. Can you explain to me, sir, how to punctuate? So since sir is what you are addressing the person in front, so sir has to be separated out by commas. Otherwise it will get mixed up in the sentence and sentence might mean something else. Now similarly, next is mild interjections. The line has got shifted. Mild interjections should be moved up. So well, this will do. So well is an interjection. Oh, I get it. So after interjection, there should be a comma. Yes and no is also should be one line up. So yes, I will. After no, there should be a comma. No, he won't. This has been missed out. So we have finished unequal syntactic commas, that is unconditional commas. No, there should be a comma. It was missed out while we composed it. I said there should be a comma.
But they need not be also.
No?
They need not also be.
Yeah, but it clarifies the meaning. Then conditional is depending on meaning. That is introductory clause. This you will meet often. When you are describing something, you will have an introductory clause and then the main sentence. So if it is introductory clause, which is long, when we write for an educated reader, this is an introductory clause, we should use commas properly. How do we know this is introductory clause? Because even the remaining part of the sentence makes sense by itself. The introductory clause is only adding some information about the sentence. The remaining sentence stands alone. So this is an introductory clause. But if it is short, the sentence, and if the reader can make out the meaning, then you need not put a comma. So the same sentence we have shortened, when we write, we should use commas properly. Now we need not use a comma. This is optional. Then prepositional phrase. As per grammar, commas have different uses. This as per grammar is called a prepositional phrase. Having decided to use commas, we should use them properly. Next we go to commas between elements. That is between clauses. So the essay which the student wrote was good. The actual sentence can be the essay was good. But we are adding information about the essay by putting another clause which the student wrote. But it can also be the paragraph with its undue length was difficult to read. It could be paragraph was difficult to read.
Will these things get pointed out by a grammar checker, like for instance in Word?
You find out how many people have used. I think beyond the spell check, it's very difficult to use a grammar checker. Okay, it doesn't understand the meaning. The software doesn't understand meaning, which only a human being can. Okay, then past participle. Here also shifting has occurred. In this column, the entries have shifted. So past participle is commas used in proper places, because used is a past participle, means PLE. The clause is called participle clause. We had past participle and present participle above. These are the participle phrases. So commas used in proper places clarify the meaning. Similarly, present participle, this PAL, the spelling is PAL because it's an adjective, and participle PLE was a noun. So commas dividing a sentence into meaningful elements help the reader. Here optionally the comma may be eliminated. The last column says, appositive means noun substitute. So no course, not even technical writing, improved the student's English. Because not even technical writing is a whole thing becomes a noun. And the last is called adverbial. That is following the main clause. Like we have introductory clause, we have a telling clause which comes at the end of the sentence. That should also be separated. So the meaning may be guessed even if commas are missing. We could have reversed the sentence and said, even if commas are missing, meaning may be guessed. Then it would be become an introductory clause. And phrase, he checked all errors of punctuation, of grammar, and of construction. So these are separate phrases, of grammar and of construction. So they are separated by commas. So this is about the summary of rules for commas. You need not know which rule you are using because you will be using it intuitively. You are already doing it. But if in doubt, you can try to classify what is the situation, whether you are working between equal elements and unequal elements, or between clauses, between phrases, and then you can clear your doubt. After you have done practice, you don't need this sheet. But till that time, we have given the sheet to everybody. And we have also given a smaller version, which is on A4. You can put it in a folder and put on the wall behind your desk or something, that anytime you can have a quick reference. Yeah. The exercise which we did, that we want to collect. So you collect and send it to one place. I just tell the in 1 minute. I'll tell. Okay, while these sheets are being collected, now I'll tell you the human reason for doing proofreading. We saw the technical reason. Human reason is like this, that suppose you have written a paper and you haven't bothered to proofread it and you ask somebody to read it. That person has to take the trouble of finding out your errors. It's like having potholes or roadblocks, and he has to navigate that and get fed up. So suppose you had a guest in your house and you have prepared something but not tested it yourself, and you offer it to the guest that you please have it. The guest will say, why don't you have with me? You say, no, I won't have it. You have it. Then the guest will become suspicious that if it is good enough for the guest, it should be good enough for yourself also. So if you are offering something to be read by others, then it's minimum courtesy that you should read it yourself and you should find it acceptable. This is a human reason for doing proof editing, besides other technical reasons. Just out of courtesy, you have to proofread your own writing.
So I'll just remind you now, tonight is the deadline to submit your assignment, if you like. It's a summary of a TED talk and your critique. It's very important that we get your critique, what you feel about it. So I've given some guidelines in that mail which I've sent. And this is a very important exercise because we need to find out who you are first. And the next step from next week, we'll start taking you into the process of splitting you up into groups and starting work on your own talk, a TED talk which will be done in groups of six in the class, right? So we'll lead you through the entire exercise, and that's what we'll do until the end of the semester. Okay? So do give that document to us by tonight. We want to look at those documents before we meet you in class on Thursday. Yeah? Thanks.